you, madam. Very good morning to all, and I welcome you to this first master class of Pune OBGY Society. This POGS Star master class we have organized with the concept that in COVID times, students, especially the PG students, are busy working in COVID wards, and their time of learning academics has really gone down. They are getting less exposure. Even the teaching is being affected. So we thought that how we could help our PG students in these difficult times. So we have planned case-based discussion with practical question-answer session as you present your long case in your final examination. And the blessing in this hard time is, because of COVID, as it is virtual, we can also get excellent examiners from all over the country for having you the real experience of Viva. How we will go ahead today is, we will have a case presentation with examination of the patient, and this would be a pre-recorded video. We have four examiners, two externals and two internals, like we have in our exams, and they will ask you questions in turns. Then there would be a small quiz for the delegates in MCQ format. Then this quiz is running all during this session of case presentation and the discussion. If you have any questions, put it in question answer box, and we will try to put these questions for examiners if they have not discussed during the discussion. So all your queries will get sorted. That is what is the plan. For today's session, we have the topic as multiple pregnancy, and we have AFMC students, Major Shovik and Major Amit, presenting the case and the examination. Conveners, myself, Dr. Vaishali Kode Nayak. I'm General Secretary of Pune OBGY Society and Professor and Head of the Department at Mimer Medical College. And with me, I have co-convener, Lieutenant Colonel Vikram Bharadwaj, his Associate Professor at AFMC Pune. I welcome Colonel Vikram. And we have an esteemed panel of examiners today, and we are really lucky to have them for this topic especially. To begin with, we have Dr. Sunita Tandulkar, President POGS. She is also head of the department at Ruby Hall Clinic. She is the examiner. And I request Madam to give President's remarks to begin with. Madam, please unmute yourself.
Thank you for making me unmute, first of all. Thank you for that. And thank you for this beautiful masterclass. It's very important. We all academicians, we are busy in our practice. Our students are busy with their COVID timing. The medical colleges, the students are posted here and there. And really, the students are suffering, as you say. It's a mental torture, also emotional. They can see the labor patient in pain, but seeing the COVID patient in a pain is a torture, emotional turmoil. And on the top of that, if there is no academics, and it's more than one year gone, it's a frustration which is coming in. So I really appreciate, I think irrespective of COVID, we had decided we'll do the master class, let's be honest. So because you get to meet so many examiners, but I need to thank this COVID pandemic, because otherwise Manjuji or Aparna would not have been with us. So let's move on without wasting much time. And I welcome all the students. We are going to work out whether it should be on a third Sunday of every month or whether it is weekday of a night, maybe 8:30 when no residents have rounds or anything. Maybe we will reschedule depending upon how it goes. But definitely it will happen every month. Vaishali Kode herself, being a professor and general secretary of this organization, I'm very sure she will ensure that this program runs entirely flawless throughout the year. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you so much, ma'am, for those kind words. And I have unmuted 7 people who are going to speak. Rest all are muted by Sanjay Bedi. And I'm not going to mute anyone now. So that will be with you if you want to unmute or mute.
Vaishali, I think if I mute myself, huh? I cannot unmute unless you do. Okay. Just see now. Okay. Once more, you can see the trial because you were talking. I muted myself and I could not. I will just do the trial.
Yeah. So can you unmute yourself, ma'am? No. Okay. So then I have to unmute you.
Yeah.
Okay. So I request now these 7 people, even if you remain unmuted, if visible, that would be great, or I will do that accordingly. Now, we are really fortunate to have Dr. Manju Puri today, and it's a pleasure of POGIS, and I tell you all students, this is really a pleasure to have you as an examiner and have this session running in front of you. She is Director, Professor, and Head of the Department of OBGYN at Lady Hardinge Medical College, New Delhi. Madam is presently Chairperson, Safe Motherhood Committee of AOGD. And Madam is an excellent examiner. My DNB examination, Madam was expert, and that day I have not yet forgotten. And such a positive vibe on the day of examination is a comfort feeling. And I can't thank you enough, ma'am. I still remember the day. Thank you so much for accepting our invitation. Then we have our own Brigadier Aruna Menon as another internal examiner. Madam is presently Professor and Head of the Department of OBGYN at AFMC Pune. Madam is alumni of AFMC Pune. She has done a post-graduation and it's really creditable where you have done post-graduation, you become Head of the Department in the same institute. And Madam is again a treasure for us. She's been guiding me and cooperating a lot for this session. Thank you so much for all your kind cooperation and I welcome you for this session now. And we have a good friend of us, Dr. K. Aparna Sharma, Additional Professor, Division of Maternal and Fetal Medicine, Department of OBGYN, AIIMS, New Delhi. Aparna, we are seeing you every day on some webinar. You are so busy and still you have taken out time and joined us. And definitely for multiple gestations, we need you and looking forward to have a very good to the point answers to those difficult questions which students find difficult, like screening and what is to be done. And we are sure that at the end of the session, all these questions would be cleared for the students. I welcome all the examiners on behalf of POGIS. And now I invite my co-convener, Colonel Vikram, to please introduce the students who are presenting the case today. Colonel Vikram Bharadwaj.
Thank you, ma'am.
Two, three important thing. There is a lot of whistle comes when you are speaking. Even in chat box, everyone is saying voice is not clear. Probably your connections, just see. But I request you make 4 examiner unmute because Aruna ji is asking you to unmute and I can understand while talking, it is very difficult for you to read the chat. So please unmute the examiners and students in one go.
Yes. They all are unmuted, but I request them not to mute themselves now.
Please unmute Manju ji also. Manju madam and Aparna. Aparna is not able to unmute herself. Just click once more. Yeah. Aparna, it's gone again. I think Sanjay Bedi sir ko pooch ke dekho if we can make everyone unmute and then we request students to mute themselves.
You can unmute yourself now. Anyone can unmute yourself.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Vaishali.
Close her headphone because her own sound is reflecting and coming as a hissing sound.
Yeah. She understood. She will disconnect it.
Good morning to all of you. Now I will introduce both the PT residents for today's first master class. We have Dr. Major Shovik Nandi, who is a third year PG resident from Armed Forces Medical College. He is first going to show us a video presentation in which he is going to narrate the history of the patient, followed by a video of the clinical examination, and finally the summary of the case. After this video presentation is over, he will be joined by Major Amit Dahiya, who is another third year PG resident from Armed Forces Medical College, Pune. And both of them will be participating in the question answer session by our experts. Over to Major Shovik Nandi.
Good morning, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes, Shovik, very much.
Yeah. Good morning, ma'am. I will be... Vaishali, ma'am, you need to stop the sharing, ma'am, so that I can start sharing the video, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
My patient, Mrs. Shibija, 38-year-old resident of Kerala, educated up to class 12, belonging to upper middle socioeconomic status as per modified Koppuswamy scale.
Ma'am, is the video visible and audible?
Yes, Shovik, it
is. Yes, it is.
Yes, ma'am, I'll be starting with the case presentation now.
My patient, Mrs. Shibija, 38-year-old resident of Kerala, educated up to class 12, belonging to upper middle socioeconomic status as per modified Koppuswamy scale, presented with complaints of amenorrhea for last 8 months of duration with raised BP recording during routine antenatal visit, hence admitted for fetomaternal evaluation. As per her menstrual history, her LMP was on 1st of September 2020, bringing her estimated date of delivery to 8th of June 2021. And her current period of gestation is 34 weeks, 5 days period of gestation. She is a primary gravida. History of this present pregnancy. This was a post-IVF ODET conception, and it was confirmed by urine pregnancy test followed by beta-HCG and a transvaginal scan. Her initial blood investigations in the first trimester, as per the patient, were told to be normal. Her scan, which revealed a twin gestation, was done early in the first trimester. She was, however, then started on folate supplementation, Ecosprin, LMWH, progesterone in various forms as injections, weekly injections and daily tablets. And she was then also started on thyroxine, 12.5 micrograms OD. However, she had no complaints of fever, pain abdomen, any rash over the body, bleeding PV, or any foul-smelling discharge per vaginum in the first trimester. In the second trimester, she had regular follow-up and medications. She was started on iron and calcium supplementations at around 16 to 18 weeks. Quickening was perceived by my patient at around 20 weeks period of gestation. She had no complaints of any fever with rash, pain abdomen, any bleeding PV or abnormal discharge per vaginum. As per her, all the investigations done at around 12 to 14 weeks period of gestation that involved ultrasound with a blood test to check whether the baby had any anomalies was normal. Then an anomaly scan done at around 18 weeks was also told to be normal. She underwent cervical encephalage at 15 weeks period of gestation, which as per the patient was told that since she had twin gestation, this was a prophylactic encephalage which was given to her. At around 24 weeks period of gestation, the routine blood test which was done was DIPSI for the patient, which was abnormal. The patient gave the values of 2 to 2 milligrams per deciliter. Once diagnosed with gestational diabetes, the patient was then put on medical nutritional therapy for initial 1 week, but she did not have regular sugar values. The patient was advised for 6-point sugar values, but out of which 5 were deranged. The patient was then put on oral hypoglycemic agents in the form of tablet metformin, 1 gram SRPD. And since then, the patient has had a well-controlled, euglycemic well-controlled. The patient had a BP recording of 144 by 96 millimeters of mercury at around 22 weeks period of gestation. Then she was admitted for the same to rule out other secondary causes of hypertension, in which her USG was done for renal evaluation, which was told to be normal to her. A fundoscopy was done, which was also normal. In the third trimester, till now, she has had regular follow-up and regular medications detected with raised BP around 3 weeks back, with the BP recording in OPD was 148 by 94 millimeters of mercury. And she was admitted for the same. She, however, had no complaints of any headache, any blurring of vision, any vomiting, pain in the epigastric region, reduced urine output, or any complaints of reduced fetal movements. Neither did she have any complaints of syncope, loss of consciousness, any palpitations, dyspnea, or any chest pain. As per past history, my patient had undergone infertility workup in 2016, in which she underwent hysteroscopy with laparoscopy. In hysteroscopy, the findings told to her was normal, whereas in laparoscopy, there were pelvic additions which the patient wrote. As per the family history, her both mother and father are diabetic. Along with that, they're also hypertensive, but under control with medications. However, the patient does not have any history of hypertension, diabetes in the past. Coming to the general examination of the patient is well-built and has good nutritional status. Has normal gait. The general condition of my patient is fair. Her height is 165 centimeters. Her weight is 96 kg, bringing her BMI to 35.26 kg per meter square. The total weight gain in pregnancy till date is 12 kg. My patient is fully conscious to time, place, and person. Has normal mood, is well coherent, and has comprehensible speech. However, has no abnormal breath or malodorous. Coming to the head-to-toe examination, on general examination, her on face, my patient has melasma present. On examination of the eyes, there is no pallor, no icterus. On ocular examination, there is no periorbital edema. On perioral examination, there is no angular chelitis. Tongue appears normal. There is no markings on the tongue. However, there is no pallor also. And and there is no icterus also. Coming to the lymph node assessment, the cervical lymph nodes, the posterior group of cervical lymph nodes, there is no lymphadenopathy palpable. Coming to the examination for sinuses, there is no central sinuses around the lips, neither does she have any acrosinuses or the peripheral sinuses over the nail beds. Her nails appear normal. There is no choidonychia or any nail biting. Coming to the examination for clubbing, the Shamrock sign is positive. The window is seen. Therefore, the patient has no clubbing. Coming to the examination of the arms and the skin, there are no rashes or any abnormal scratch marks present over the skin. Continuing with the skin examination, patient has acanthosis nigricans present over the nape of the neck. Coming to the examination for pigmental edema, my patient has pigmental edema present bilaterally. and it is of it is grade 2 pedal edema and bilaterally present. Now we examine the pulse of my patient. The pulse is of normal volume, normal rhythm. It's 72 beats per minute. There is no radio radial. And no radiofemoral delay. The BP taken in right arm supine position is 138 by 90 millimeters of mercury. JVP of my patient is also normal and not raised. Now we go ahead with the paratonal examination. Before that, I have explained my patient regarding the procedure which I would be doing. And I have asked my patient to void her bladder and then I would be going ahead with the exam. First, we do the inspection of the abdomen. Before that, I have exposed the abdomen from zippy sternum up till pubic symphysis. The abdomen is globally distended. The flanks do not appear to be full. The umbilicus is central and it is flattened. There is a well-healed transverse previous laparoscopic scar just present below the umbilicus. Linea nigra is clearly visible. Stria gravidarum is present. However, there are no other scars, sinuses, or any dilated veins seen over the abdomen. So now we go ahead with the palpation. So first, I will measure the abdominal girth for my patient at the level of navel area, which corresponds to 123 centimeters. Now we assess for the bundle height of my patient. For that, I need to first centralize the uterus, as we know that the uterus is dextrorotated. Once we centralize the uterus from the zippy sternum, I would be coming down, and at the level where I get the first incision, this is corresponding to 36 weeks period of gestation, and my patient today is at 34 weeks, 5 days period of gestation. Now we assess for the symphysial bundle height, for which where I have marked the fundal height, from there I would be going up to the pubic symphysis. Yes, that corresponds to 45 centimeters. Now we go ahead with the obstetrical grips. On the first Leopold's maneuver, in the fundal grip I am getting a soft, broad, irregular structure, probably the podalic end of one of the twins. Coming to the second Leopold's maneuver, on the left side, I am able to palpate multiple knobby structures, probably the limbs of the baby. And on the right side, I can palpate a curved, hard structure, that is probably the back of the baby. Coming to the third Leopold maneuver, I am getting a hard, palatable structure, probably the cephalic end of one of the twins. And coming to the fourth Leopold maneuver, the head is not engaged. Auscultate for the fetal heart rate. I'm able to auscultate the first twin. Heart rate is nearly 150 beats per minute. Now, for auscultating the second twin, I might use assistance of a second assistant, or the place where I auscultate for the second twin should be at least 10 centimeters apart from the first twin, and the beats should be at least 10 beats per minute. The difference should be there. So yes, this is the place where I got the pictures for the second twin, which is nearly 130 beats per minute, and the difference between the two auscultating sites is more than 10 centimeters.
Finally, to summarize, my patient, she is a 38-year-old primi gravida at 34 weeks, 5 days period of gestation, post IVF ODET conception with DADC twins with first twin in cephalic presentation, with gestational hypertension, GDM on metformin 1 gram SR BD, elderly gravida being her age of 38 years, with morbid obesity, with cervical encerclage in C2, currently not in labor.
Ma'am, I'm done with my presentation.
Very nice, Novik. Very nicely told. Now the discussion would start, and I request Manju Madam to begin the Viva, please.
So thank you, and it is indeed to be a pleasure on this platform with all pleasant people in the morning and lovely presentation. I was actually feeling as if I am right there and the student is actually presenting. So very wonderfully, recorded. So very good idea. So I think it's given us that idea also, we can also do the same way. So wonderful and very well presented and very well summarized. So that's really good. I would want to ask as to what is the right position in which you should be recording the blood pressure in a pregnant woman?
Ma'am, it should be measured once the patient is sitting, ma'am. And in sitting position, the arm should be rested on the table at the level of heart we should be measuring. And the patient should be sitting for at least 10 to 15 minutes before we take the blood pressure, ma'am. She should not be having any caffeine products just below the before the measurement. And once we have measured, ma'am, it has to be measured in right arm supine position. The hand should be in right arm supine position, and back should be rested on the chair, and the patient should be in a reclining position, ma'am. Should not be sitting straight, ma'am.
No, but why are we saying supine position when we are saying that she has to be reclining? Because yes, if you see, she should be in a supine position. So that does not mean she is reclining.
Ma'am. Patient should be in a sitting position and the arm should be rested on the table, ma'am. When we are taking the BP, ma'am.
So why do you not want her to be supine?
Ma'am, in supine position, the gravid uterus would be pressing over the IVC, ma'am. That would reduce the preload. That is why we would get a reduced BP recording, ma'am, instead of a normal BP recording, which we should get. So that is why we measure it in a sitting position, ma'am.
So I think that is very important. The second is that when we demonstrate icterus, so do we ask the patient to, which part of the pelvis?
Ma'am, actually, I recorded it wrong, ma'am. It should be the patient should be looking down and I should be seeing it over the upper sclera, ma'am. And it should be seen in outer light, ma'am, not in a room lit environment.
Perfect. The next important thing is that, when we are doing a palpation for the patient where we are suspecting twin pregnancy. So your hand movements also should be, describing as to what are you looking for. So when you were doing the abdominal examination, I don't know whether I missed it out, but it was like you were examining a singleton pregnancy. So that's the feel which I got. So you were not trying to look for another pole somewhere and, and multiple fetal parts. So those are the things which should be kind of visible while we are palpating the multiple pregnancy. Am I able to make my point?
Yeah.
So what all would you look for when you are, doing a abdominal palpation for a twin pregnancy?
Ma'am, in twin pregnancy, ma'am, firstly on abdominal palpation, ma'am, the uterine height would be more than period of gestation. That would suggest a multifetal gestation. Secondly, ma'am, on further abdominal examination, I would be getting, instead of two poles, I'd be getting three poles. That is suggestive of a twin gestation, ma'am. So with that, I would get an idea that yes, this is possibly a twin gestation. So further to this, when I do the grips, ma'am, on grips, I might not get a clear finding of a pelvic end, a podalic end or a cephalic end on one of the grips, ma'am. That is again suggestive of multifetal gestation, ma'am.
No, but where do you look for two poles? which grip? I'm to say, when you do the fundal grip, should you be looking for two poles there? Where are you expecting the poles normally to be?
Ma'am, the two poles would be wider apart, ma'am. As in, not in the fundal grip. On the lateral grips, I might get two poles, ma'am. Or in the third grip, when I do, ma'am, I'll not get a single. I might get a curved back structure, ma'am. So that is again showing that the fetus is an abnormal lie, and possibly with three poles, this could be a twin gestation.
So at least you should try and look for more than one head, which would be quite obvious. So even at the fundal grip, if you feel a broad part on one side, there could be a head on the other side. Okay, and then you do the same when you do the pelvic grip and on the lateral grip. So that is what one should try and look for.
Yes.
All right, so excellent. So now we just move on to, in this particular patient, this is a patient who's got IVF pregnancy. I'm just addressing the basics. So if you calculate the EDD in a patient who's undergone an IVF pregnancy, what do you consider? How do you calculate the
Ma'am, with the IVF conception, ma'am, we get the date of embryo transfer. And from the date of embryo transfer, we minus around 16 days, ma'am, we get the LMP. And from that, we calculate the date of pregnancy, ma'am, which was done for the same patient, ma'am.
So I think it's always good to, do it from the day of embryo transfer.
Yes.
All right. So now this is a patient who underwent the IVF pregnancy. So she would go for the ultrasound in her first trimester.
Shani, can you request everyone to mute themselves? Many participants have not muted themselves and the noise has started coming. Yeah. Thank you.
So Shaumik, I would want you to tell me, as to in a twin pregnancy, what do you look for in the first trimester?
Ma'am, in the first trimester, ma'am, our idea of doing an ultrasound is first to confirm that it is it's a twin gestation. Second is, ma'am, then we need to confirm whether the chorionicity of the twin gestation, ma'am, whether it is a monochorionic or a dichorionic gestation, ma'am. That would be confirmed by looking for the lambda sign or the T sign, ma'am. Lambda sign is the one where we get a inverted Y-shaped thing, ma'am, where the intermembranous thickness is more than 2 mm. That is suggestive of a dichorionic gestation. Whereas in a T membrane, that is an inverted T appearance, we would be getting a thinner membrane. So that is suggestive of a monochorionic twins. Again, to further confirm that it is a dichorionic gestation, ma'am, if it is an early gestation, if you're getting the scan done in an early gestation, if you are not able to look for this, ma'am, then we should look for if you are getting two gestational sacs, and in that, if you are getting two yolk sac, ma'am, that is again confirmatory that this is possibly a dichorionic gestation. It could be a monochorionic also, ma'am, but that needs to be confirmed on later ultrasound where we get a amniotic membrane in between. After this, ma'am, in the early gestation, by around up to 10 weeks, ma'am, we need to look for any major fetal anomalies in both the twins, ma'am. Once we have confirmed the dichorionicity, anencephaly is one which we can rule out at around 10 weeks period of gestation, ma'am. And once she goes into second trimester, we need to do further scans for her.
Anything else which you would like to look up in the first trimester, late first trimester?
Ma'am,
other than chorionicity?
Late first trimester, at around 11 weeks up till 13 weeks, ma'am, we should be looking for nuchal translucency and nasal bone for both the fetuses.
All right. So why are you so much concerned about chorionicity?
Ma'am, chorionicity in cases of a monochorionic twins, ma'am, twin gestation, they are at an increased risk for all the comorbidities which are associated with a single twin, ma'am. But in cases of monochorionicity, ma'am, there are certain comorbidities or certain complications which we should expect, such as inter-twin transfusion syndromes, ma'am, which are more dreaded. So if a monochorionic pregnancy is diagnosed, that pregnancy is required frequent and stricter evaluations instead of a DADC pregnancy, ma'am. So that is why we need to look whether it is a monochorionic gestation or a dichorionic gestation.
Why is it that in monochorionic pregnancy, the complication rate is higher?
Ma'am, with monochorionic gestation, with monochorionic pregnancy, ma'am, the placenta has certain anastomosis, ma'am. The placenta has certain superficial anastomosis and certain deep anastomosis. The superficial anastomosis are present mostly in all of the monochorionic gestations, ma'am, where there is arterio-arterial and arterio-venous anastomosis, ma'am. But the anastomosis of relevance is the deeper anastomosis. Those are the arterio-venous anastomosis, which are present in nearly 30 to 40% of monochorionic pregnancies, ma'am. What happens is this superficial anastomosis, they try to balance the flow of blood from one twin to other twin. But if this deeper anastomosis, that is the arteriovenous anastomosis, is also working, then it makes a third circulation where from one of the twins where the artery is running, it will pump the blood to the other twin, ma'am. And that will manifest with twin to twin transfusion and further complications associated with monochorionic pregnancy.
So it is to do with the direction of flow. So if it is bi-directional balanced, then there is no problem. But in case it is unbalanced, in that case, these problems would arise. Can this arise in dichorionic pregnancy as well?
Ma'am, in dichorionic pregnancies, ma'am, it is very rare to occur, ma'am. It is only, it is very rare in dichorionic pregnancies. Only if there is such anastomosis developed in the deeper circulation, then only this will develop, ma'am. But it is very rare to see in dichorionic pregnancies.
So dichorionic pregnancies usually would be spared. Right?
Yes, ma'am.
That is why we really know what is the chorionicity, right? So that is why, supposing a patient is missed out on this kind of a scan, right? So no one, someone has not done it in the first trimester. So how do we manage this pregnancy subsequently? Would you like to consider it as a diamniotic? Would you like to dichorionic, or would you like to consider it as a monochorionic?
Ma'am, sensitivity of ultrasound till 14 to 16 week, it is 95%, ma'am, to detect it as monochorionic or dichorionic, ma'am. And till 24 week, ma'am, it is almost 94%, ma'am. Till 24 week by ultrasound, we can detect, ma'am. And ultrasound is the best mode of modality which is available with us, ma'am, to detect the chorionicity and amniocity of the fetus, ma'am. And this will further decide the time of delivery of the fetus.
Yes. So basically, you will try and look at and try and understand what is the, chorionicity. But in case you cannot, then it is much better to treat it as a monochorionic pregnancy as compared to considering it, presuming that it would be dichorionic. Right. So that is one thing. Okay. So I think we now look at, what would be your protocol for a patient who is protocol for an antenatal checkup, which you would like to put in place. Would it be any different from a singleton pregnancy, or is it going to be the same?
Ma'am, in case of twin pregnancies, especially in monochorionic, ma'am, till 24 week of period of gestation, ma'am, every 2 weekly, I'll want to check whether there are any before 24 weeks, ma'am, if any congenital anomalies are there, ma'am, or any features of TTS are there, ma'am. And after 24 to 26 week period of gestation, ma'am, I'll like to check for any IUGR in any of the babies, ma'am.
Let's first look at what is the difference between the monitoring of a twin pregnancy versus singleton pregnancy. How is it different? So let's understand the basic concept first, and then we move on to the dichorionic and monochorionic pregnancy monitoring. Okay.
Ma'am, if the ma'am, basically frequent monitoring of twins is required, ma'am, by ultrasound than singleton pregnancy, ma'am.
Why do you want to do it by ultrasound? Why not do it like we do it in singleton pregnancy?
Ma'am, chances of first of all, chances of anomalies are less in singleton pregnancy, ma'am, and complications are also less in singleton pregnancy, ma'am. That is why we like to do frequent monitoring in twin pregnancy.
What complications are more in twin pregnancy, which you cannot, you said that you would, there are more complications in twin pregnancy. That is why you want to do an ultrasonic monitoring.
Yes, ma'am. So, ma'am, before 24 week period of gestation, I'll like to look for congenital anomalies in both the fetus, ma'am. And I like to do cervical monitoring, ma'am, cervical length monitoring, ma'am. Twin pregnancy are more prone for preterm labor, preterm deliveries, ma'am. and a PPR, ma'am. And that is why cervical length monitoring is required, ma'am.
I was asking you, why do you want to do an ultrasound monitoring as opposed to clinical monitoring in a singleton pregnancy? That's the question, isn't it, Dr. Manju?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Ma'am, in cases of twin gestation, ma'am, there are certain maternal complications which are expected vis-a-vis a singleton pregnancy, ma'am. Where in cases of twins, there is higher chances of anemia. So, on clinical examination,
ma'am is asking you, what about clinical examination?
It's a basic question what ma'am is asking, that why do you want, you are doing a clinical examination for growth in a singleton, right? You are doing a symphysiofundal height monitoring in a singleton, but why you are doing an ultrasound monitoring in twin?
Ma'am, in cases of twin gestation, the symphysiofundal height does not correspond to the period of gestation, as in it is always more in cases of twin gestation. So we'll get a wrong estimate of the gestation. So that is why we require a closer intensive monitoring in the form of ultrasound, which will help us to see whether the fetus are getting adequate growth or not.
Perfect. So your other examiners have given you a clue to answer. So you've answered it well. So Vishali, want to come in?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much. It was really a nice session and you both did quite well. Now I request Aruna Menon, ma'am, to please continue. And ma'am, we are seeing those internal examiner's expressions that, it's really giving that feel of exam, and we can see your expressions. And please, ma'am, it is the session you will conduct now. I request you.
I thought it was again the external examiner. Fine, no problem. So who's answering next? Amit?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So my question to you is, when you are... you were talking about complications in twin pregnancy, right?
Yes, ma'am.
And one of the dreaded complications that we all know is preterm birth. So what would you do to either to predict it or to avoid it?
Ma'am, in twin pregnancy, ma'am, cervical length monitoring can be done, ma'am. Okay. If it is less than 2 centimeters, ma'am, then delivery before 34-week prediction is around 95%, ma'am.
When will you start this monitoring?
Ma'am, I'll start monitoring between 14 to 16 week period of gestation, ma'am. Till 24 week, ma'am.
This patient has got a prophylactic encerclage. Is there any role of a prophylactic encerclage in twin pregnancy?
No, ma'am. There's no role of prophylactic encerclage in twin pregnancy.
So then where was this done?
Yes, ma'am. Only role of rescue encerclage is there.
Yeah. So what is rescue encerclage?
Ma'am, the... in case of if the cervix has started dilating, ma'am, like 3 to 4 centimeters, ma'am, and patient is not in labor, ma'am, threatened preterm labor is there, ma'am. In that case, we can.
Centimeters, she is in labor. There's no doubt. Or whatever. She is in preterm labor, isn't it? But you would like to do a rescue encerclage too?
Just to prolong the pregnancy, ma'am.
To try and prolong it. So if you give a rescue encerclage, by how much can you prolong it?
Ma'am, we make the short-term target and long-term target, ma'am. As long as we can prolong the pregnancy, ma'am, with the use of tocolysis for steroid exhibition, ma'am, and 2-week target we can take.
Okay. Any other method that has been described? We are not using it very... it's not being used so much, but then it has been definitely found to be useful. So any other method?
Ma'am, progesterone support can also be given, ma'am. And
what kind of progesterone support?
Ma'am, proluton depot can be given, ma'am, and micro vaginal pessaries can also be used, ma'am. But whatever research has been done on that, ma'am, they do not prevent preterm delivery, ma'am, but prophylactically we can use them, ma'am.
So as of now, we're using them for the same indications that we use them in singleton.
Yes, ma'am.
They don't have any extra, help in twin pregnancy. Yes, Shaubik, anything else that you've heard of?
Ma'am, Arabin pessary is one which we can, we don't use, ma'am, much, but there are certain trials which are comparing between Arabin pessary versus micronized progesterone, ma'am.
In fact, they have started doing it in Delhi, and I don't know about the other examiners can pitch in whether they've started using it.
And ma'am, we've got very good results by using. Yes, Dr. Aparna, I think you would be able to give us.
Yeah, so ma'am, Arabin pessary actually is a lot of controversy around it, because the only people who actually found it useful was the one who made it. So it was not actually found to be useful in the other studies. So there's a lot of controversy.
It's still a question mark.
Yes. Yeah. So it's still a question mark. But yes, ma'am, very good point regarding progesterone is that if the cervical length is short, then there is a role of vaginal progesterone.
Micronized progesterone.
Yes, vaginal micronized progesterone, if it is in, like it would be in a singleton pregnancy. But otherwise, because twin pregnancy itself has a risk of preterm delivery, so there is not much of, you know, lot of use of prophylactic progesterone like that.
But definitely when the cervical length is short.
Yes, on a first trimester scan or a 22 to 24 week scan, if the cervical length is short, then there is a role of vaginal progesterone. In at least there is a RCT of six in that has been found to be useful.
That's right. Okay,
ma'am. If I request Sunita madam to please. Yeah.
Let's continue with the history. Since this is an ART pregnancy at 40 age, you said, you first of all, I need to congratulate you people. Fantastic recording, fantastic presentation, clinical examination. I can understand a little mistake of an icterus and pelor. You did it a little differently. Maybe your palpation of the pedal edema site also, I feel little differently. Upper abdominal examination, fundal height in a multiple pregnancy may not matter much. And as Manju madam has rightly said, your palpation were looking for a recording purpose, more of a singleton than real palpation. If you would have really thought of, I want to see how are the babies lie, whether vertical, transverse, bowish, then you probably would have looked more natural. But I can understand that with the complete video shooting and totally different atmosphere. Now I would like to go back to the history taking. When your patient had come for a history of an IVF pregnancy in some other place, what more you would have liked to know about this?
In the preconceptual period, ma'am, or she has conceived and then come? Ma'am?
How she conceived? She conceived with IVF at the age of 40 is little gross. Would you like to ask more details about it?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I need to ask her about her history of infertility, ma'am. As in, why was the infertility there and whether she has had any treatment for the same in the past, whether she tried for any spontaneous conception and she did not conceive, following which, what were the investigations done for that? And why was this current IVF indicated in her, ma'am? So that needs to be asked in history, ma'am. So
right. Now, two, three important things which probably in a routine OBGY practice you may not encounter. I will ask at 40 age, age 40 itself, we all know that ART pregnancies are high-risk pregnancy. At 40, she conceived with twins. So whether it was a self egg or a donor egg, the studies have proven with the donor egg, very high chance of developing the PIH in subsequent pregnancy.
This was a donor egg, ma'am, in this case.
So what was her cause of infertility?
Ma'am, cause of her infertility was poor ovarian reserve, which was told to her, ma'am. Her AMH was around 0.6, ma'am. So
duration of a marriage was?
Ma'am, duration, she was married for 11 years and cohabiting for last 9 years frequently, ma'am. Under evaluation, but somehow she was tried with ovulation induction around 4 to 6 times, ma'am. But she did not succeed with that. And with poor ovarian reserve, she was not then tried for IUI. She was directly taken up for IVF.
Right. So unexplained pregnancy, this then the decreased ovarian reserve. Why I'm asking this? Because if the patient is conceived with the polycystic ovaries, then again, with the multiple pregnancy, they have a very high chances. IVF pregnancy itself giving gestational diabetes and hypertension, plus in addition, PCOS patient. Now here, the 40 age. Do you think weight gain during her pregnancy was very important to consider?
Yes, ma'am. Weight gain is absolutely important, ma'am. Firstly, she is morbidly obese, ma'am. Her BMI was 35 kg per meter square, ma'am. So for her, the weight gain should have been around 6 to 8 kgs in the complete pregnancy, ma'am. Whereas the total pregnancy gain till 34 weeks was around 12 kgs in her, ma'am. So again, that 12 kgs weight gain shows there is higher risk of development of GDM, which was there in my patient, and also hypertension, which was there in my patient. So these two factors, they come in place.
Fantastic. So preconceptional weight of the patient, especially at the age of 40, when we are giving pregnancy, we should be careful, and the weight gain during the pregnancy. So what diet you will advise to this woman? If she would have been with you, you are the person who have done her embryo transfer. What precautions you would have taken before the embryo transfer and after the embryo transfer?
Ma'am, about regarding the diet, ma'am.
I'm asking overall. Okay, you can consider the diet. You said you would have allowed only 6 kgs in 9 months, 6 to 8 kgs. So how you would have calculated that diet?
Ma'am, her diet should contain, if she is obese, ma'am, like her BMI is 35, ma'am. Her diet should contain 55% of carbohydrate and around 20% of protein and 25% of fat, ma'am. And
or do you think it should be little reverse way, more of a proteins and this one and less of carbs?
Ma'am, it is written in Williams.
Okay.
The diet should have around whatever composition sir has told, ma'am. But the overall intake should be around 1500 kilocalories in a day, ma'am. And yeah, that should be told that this patient should divide it into frequent meals, ma'am. She should not take one binge meal at a time. So she can take 3 major meals and 3 minor meals, which can be told to her. And in those meals, we can specify that if you're getting a total calorie intake of around 1500 kilocalories, we can divide it into 9 parts. And that 9 parts can be then given 2 parts in the morning in the breakfast, 2 parts in the lunch, and 2 parts in the night. Remaining could be given in between as snacks, ma'am. So that we need to reiterate to the patient, ma'am. And the patient can follow it, ma'am.
Ma'am, for 20
pregnancies. Very well answered. I really appreciate. One more important thing I just want to guide. When Manju madam was asking you, how will you consider the gestational age, how you will calculate, still more further into, you should have asked whether it was a blastocyst transfer or day 2 embryo transfer or day 3 embryo transfer, because more closely you will be going to her delivery, whether 36 weeks, 37 weeks, it becomes really 5 days difference, and it comes to near 1 week, especially with 40 age group with gestational diabetes and other high risk factors. So I think these were the very important points, because donor eggs she has taken, she was at high risk, elderly age group, she was at high risk, preconceptional high weight, she was at high risk, and twin pregnancy, we got doubly. So do you, I asked you in a first trimester, would you think of working little differently? So can you say me something about it?
Ma'am, yes, ma'am. Patient counseling is very important in twin pregnancy, ma'am. They should be explained about the complications, maternal complication, fetal complications, ma'am, once the twin pregnancy is diagnosed, ma'am. In first trimester, ma'am, chorionicity of the fetus should be confirmed, ma'am. And screening for aneuploidies can be done in first trimester, ma'am, with the anti-NB scan, ma'am. And NIPT in cases can also be done, ma'am. And then after that, ma'am, after first trimester, ma'am, frequent 2-weekly monitoring of cervical length in twin pregnancy should be there, ma'am. Because they are more prone.
NIPT in twin pregnancy?
Yeah, they have started now, ma'am. They are doing now NIPT for twin. I think last 1 year, they started doing NIPT.
They're still not very sure of the values that have been used for cutoff.
Ma'am, we do NIPT for twins, ma'am.
Now it has started, ma'am. And they are quite sure. I was just thinking, taking YY in a different direction, if you would have asked for an embryo reduction for this patient. That's why. Nothing else. Just to give a different thought.
because she's 40, she's obese, she's a donor egg, you were knowing she's going to land up in, can you decrease her morbidity in second and third trimester by doing a first trimester embryo reduction?
Ma'am, in twin pregnancy, embryo reduction is not indicated, ma'am. But in triplet and quadruplet, ma'am, embryo reduction can be done.
Okay, thank you. Aparna, you can take over and we can go again a merry-go-round.
Yes,
right, ma'am. Yes, Aparna. Thank you, ma'am. And first of all, thank you so much. Like, really, really enjoyable. And I would really say that really a unique way of doing things. And Manjupuri, ma'am, good morning. Really pleasure to be here with you. Can I start with the history again? A few points in the history. First of all, from the postgraduate point of view, I would say never say in abbreviations. You know, you have repeatedly said ODET. Repeatedly said ODET. I don't think you should be saying that, right? So I think you wanted to say, so I think just be very, very clear on what we want to say.
Yes, ma'am.
Also, you said that the patient did DIPSI, right? So the patient will not tell you that it was DIPSI. You know that it is DIPSI. So just say that patient did a 75 gram glucose test or did a blood sugar test with a 75 gram glucose. So just to say that patient doesn't know. So you have to extract that history out of the patient. So when you're presenting history, please be very, very specific on what you have extracted out of the patient.
Yes.
Also, encerclage again. So just say that patient said that some stitch was applied. So avoid using technical terminologies.
Yes, ma'am.
In the examination, I would say when you calculate BMI, you have to be very specific that it was from the pre-pregnancy weight. So I don't know whether I did not get that clarity whether it was from the pre-pregnancy weight or it was from the present pregnancy weight, because this becomes very, very important. Because just now, Dr. Sunita ma'am said, how did you calculate the diet? Now that is very important. Why? Because when you calculate the diet, especially in an obese woman in a twin pregnancy, you have to be very sure that it is 30 to 35 kilocalorie per kg of the pre-pregnancy BMI.
Yes.
For the present pregnancy weight. Now, if she's present pregnancy weight, it is 91, but her pre-pregnancy BMI is obese.
Ma'am.
So you take the present pregnancy weight as 91, but the pre-pregnancy BMI is based on her pre-pregnancy weight.
Yes,
so please be very, very careful on how you are calculating your BMI.
Yes, ma'am.
Right. So I think that was one point I wanted to make out. Again, the consent should begin at the beginning of the examination, not at the time of abdominal examination. Right.
Yes,
so that is something that also remember when you are examining a female,
ma'am.
Right? Have a female attendant.
Yes, ma'am.
In the video, the female attendant was not there.
Okay.
Okay.
I think camera was being held by the female attendant, ma'am. But
I can't see that.
Yes.
Please have a female attendant.
Yes, ma'am.
And so be very careful on these things. And, you know, and COVID times, I don't know, the mask thing has to be there. I'm sure it was there. But
yes,
somewhere you have to be very, very careful. Again, the supine position, I also wanted to make sure about the blood pressure. Also, very important thing, abdominal girth has to be in inches, not centimeters.
Okay, ma'am.
You showed that in centimeters,
yes,
right?
Ma'am.
So this is one. The second thing is always measure symphysiofundal height first and then abdominal girth. That is like classical training. So I don't know why you did that. Like, so first is symphysiofundal height and then abdominal girth. Anyway, it's not such a big deal. And then the other thing is when you take symphysiofundal height, it has to be from the fixed point to the moving point. So it has to be from the symphysis to the fundus.
Yep.
Then you take the measurement.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. So it is always, so you put, so first you say that you come from the top to the moving point, mark the moving point, and then put your tape on the symphysis, and then you take the measurement.
Yep.
Okay. So these are some of the points when you show. And as ma'am said, just when you are describing, don't actually mention Leopold's in a twin examination. Just say, we could feel multiple fetal parts and three poles were palpable. Joes, don't even try to describe a Leopold's in a twin. So actually, twin is a better case for examination because you don't even have to break your points head over it.
Yes.
You know, Leopold, describe hi nahi karna, tension hi nahi lena. Just say multiple fetal parts palpable, three poles palpable, the presenting part is a head. Right. So that is the only thing. So good part for that. These were some of the points that I wanted to point out. The other thing is there is a difference between the thickness and the lambda, when you are trying to determine the chorionicity, lambda is for chorionicity, a short sign. It is not 2 mm. The 2 mm is the thickness of the membrane. Yes. So these are two different things. And lambda is because there are two chorions and two amnions. So that will give you the image of a triangle and a peak. And that is the lambda. Okay. And yes. The 2 mm is the thickness of the membrane, four membranes coming in. So these are two different signs to determine the chorionicity in the first trimester. And the thickness of the membrane can also be seen in the second trimester. And for the diet part, as ma'am was saying, 40% has to be from carbohydrate. And when you are talking about an obese patient, you can always say that it has to be the low glycemic index. Okay, so these are some of the points that I would like to make. And I would say that, you know, let us go back, ma'am, to the second round and I'll make my points, because there are so many more things that I would really like to talk about, because twins is something that is so close to my heart. I'd like to talk about interventions, reductions. Yes. And when you say that you talk about twin reduction, embryo reduction, I would like to talk about fetal reduction and not embryo reduction. But ma'am, we'll come back to it. So I think let's go back to Manju Puri, ma'am.
Yes, I think Manju, ma'am, I can't see. Ma'am, are you there?
Yes,
ma'am, second round.
Yeah, that's fine. So great points made. I think it is wonderful to have a mix of examiners.
Yes.
So Dr. Tendulkar, very nice points as far as the, you know, infertility part was concerned, and Aparna, very, very basic. And Dr. Aruna, I think it's been wonderful. I'm enjoying it. Yeah. So now we move on to the second round. So just a small question. Why do we want to know whether it was actually a donor oocyte or not? What difference would it make?
It is the paternity, ma'am. Elderly gravida, ma'am, more than 35 year, ma'am. Chances of maternal morbidity are more, ma'am. And since with the womb donation also, ma'am.
Loj, could you come in? I'm saying, do you want to? The other candidate is Shovik. So would you want to make a comment on that?
Ma'am, sorry, I could not hear the word, ma'am. Can you please repeat it, ma'am?
I just maternal, madam has a main objection that maternal morbidity or mortality is, whether it is donor oocyte or a self-AIDS. He's saying paternity will be different. He is saying the mortality will be high.
No. I'm just wanting to know, how would it make any difference in case we know whether it is a donor oocyte or it is patient's own conception at the age of 38 years?
Ma'am, with donor oocyte, there are higher chances of pregnancy complications in the form of hypertension and diabetes, ma'am. So that is the thing which is there in my patient also, ma'am. So that we should rule out, that we should look for once such a patient comes to me.
And even when you are interpreting, the first, you know, for down screening, when you are interpreting, so it would become important that it is the age of the donor and not the age of the patient, which would be taken into consideration while you actually calculate the risk.
Yes.
Right. So you have to make sure that you look at that very important point. All right. So I think that was one point. So now I think we can move on to the next part. So, or maybe I can move forward with what Aparna had said. Why do you want to measure the abdominal girth in inches and not centimeters? She said measure in inches. You said yes. Why?
Ma'am, this would be a uniform unit of measurement, ma'am. So that is why it is measured in a single unit, ma'am, inches. So that everywhere it is measured in the same unit. That bias is not there.
Actually, it is that the abdominal girth normally would increase by an inch every week after 32 weeks of pregnancy. Okay. And the fundal height increases by 1 centimeter usually between 18 and 32 weeks of, or 34 weeks of gestation. So fundal height always in centimeters, this always in inches. Okay. So in a singleton pregnancy, what do we expect the girth to be at 40 weeks? What is the girth, abdominal girth measurement usually in a singleton pregnancy at 40 weeks?
should be
40 inches.
14.
Right, so that is why 38 weeks, 38 inches. So that is how it is. And it increases by 1 inch per week. So that is why it is to be measured in inches. All right. So now we move again. I think Aparna can take it forward when we talk about Down's syndrome screening.
So this is the three things that I want to take when my turn comes is aneuploidy screening in twins, aneuploidy screening in advanced maternal age, and preeclampsia screening in twins. So I will take three topics when these things come.
All right. So I'll leave it at that and I will pursue differently. Now, I was asking you, how frequently would you ask them to come for antenatal checkup and what all points would you do at each antenatal visit? What will you focus on?
Before 24-week period of before 24-week period of gestation, ma'am, if twin gestation has been confirmed, ma'am,
she's in first trimester. We've confirmed it is a twin gestation. Okay, and now you tell me how frequently would you call her for? She's a dichorionic pregnancy. This patient. So how frequently would you call her for antenatal checkup, and what are you going to do in each antenatal checkup?
Ma'am, for dichorionic pregnancy, ma'am, every 4 weekly visit is required, ma'am, to do the ultrasound, ma'am. Before 24-week period of gestation, ma'am, 2 weekly visit can be done, ma'am, to detect complication in the fetuses, ma'am, if it is not dichorionic, ma'am, in case of monochorionic, ma'am.
No, I'm talking about, just focus on the question. The question being asked is, she's a dichorionic pregnancy. Now she is finished with the first trimester. How frequently are you going to call her for antenatal checkup and what all would you check? So it is a very straight question. So as a postgraduate, you should be able to tell me.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, 4 weekly visit should be there, ma'am. And her weight monitoring, BP monitoring, and advisory about exercise and diet also should be given, ma'am. And 4 weekly ultrasound in DADC twins should be done, ma'am. And after 28-week period of gestation, 2 weekly, ma'am.
Let's understand that she is in first trimester. So when will you call her next? Are you going to call her after 4 weeks? That means 16 weeks? Or would you like to now call her at 18 to 20 weeks?
Ma'am, in first trimester, ma'am, if there is a history of any preterm birth, or ma'am, we want to monitor cervical length, ma'am, then 2 weekly monitoring of that cervical length should be done, ma'am. And for anomaly scan, she should be called between 18 to 20 weeks, ma'am.
So, you know, when you are answering a question to the examiner, it is much better to divide it into two parts. Number one, when would you call her? Then what would you examine? And then what would you advise? So I think once you divide it into three parts, then the answer becomes more clear. Okay, so now because she's dichorionic pregnancy, we know she's a primigravid. I am asking you about the management of this patient. Okay, yes. So you've already done a cervical length in the first trimester. So now your next visit can be at 18 to 20 weeks. You need not call her in between. Okay, so in 18 to 20 weeks, you will ask her to come with an ultrasound. And now you should say that you have to screen her for, PIH, you have to, her blood pressure, you have to screen her for diabetes. These are the things which you should be actually keeping in mind, and then review her with her ultrasound report. Okay. And now next visit, when will you call her next? Everything is okay now. Her blood pressure is okay. Her GTT here is normal. All right. And her ultrasound is okay. Yes. So now what are you going to do?
She should be called after the anomaly scan, ma'am, at after 24-week period of gestation, ma'am. Then again to check her sugar, ma'am.
All right. Yes. So that means the next visit can be at another 4 weeks. Right. Now, supposing she was a monochorionic pregnancy. So between 13 weeks and 24 weeks, would you want to manage her differently or would it be the same?
Ma'am, for monochorionic twins, ma'am, I like to do a 2 weekly scan for her, ma'am. Starting? Yes, ma'am, pardon me.
Starting? What gestation?
Ma'am, starting after 14 to 16 week, ma'am, after the NTNS. Sure.
To be clear, are you going to, after 12 weeks, are you going to do it at 14 weeks or would you start doing it at 16 weeks?
Ma'am, before 13 weeks, 6 days period of gestation, ma'am, NT-NB scan should be done for both the twins, ma'am, and aneuploidy screening should be done, ma'am. After that, ma'am, 2 weekly screening for to detect TTS or any anomaly in the fetus should be done, ma'am. And at around 18 to 20 week, ma'am, for anomalies scan should also be included in the screening.
So let's remember that for monochorionic, between 16 and 24 weeks, there should be a 2 weekly scan to pick up, TTS. That is what should be in your mind. Is there anything on first trimester ultrasound which can give you a clue that this patient can have TTS?
Ma'am, in anti-NB scan, ma'am, if the difference in the anti is more than, or both the twins, ma'am, if it is more than 20%, ma'am, and if the difference in the CRL is more than 12 millimeter, ma'am, and difference in the amniotic fluid is more than 2 millimeter, ma'am, then it can indicate toward TTS, ma'am.
Do we look at all those things? So basically, it is the only NT, you know, if it is more, it in one fetus, it can give you a clue, but not other things. Other things are going to develop later on.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so that is how it should be. So that is what. Now, supposing there's a disparity in the size of the fetus, two fetuses in the first trimester, and you have to calculate the gestational age. So which fetus are you going to take into account?
Ma'am, the larger twin should be taken into account.
Why do you want to do that?
Because the smaller twin can be because of anomaly, ma'am, or TTS, ma'am.
So, well, yeah, so it should be the bigger one because the smaller one could be restricted. So it could be smaller because of some abnormality. So it is always better to take the bigger fetus in account. Yes. All right. So I think we are clear about it, that when we do the antenatal checkups in dichorionic, diamniotic twins, we are going to call them every 4 weeks.
Yes, sir.
So first trimester one visit, then 18 to 20 weeks another visit in case there are no other high risk factors, and then every 4 weekly. So that message should be absolutely clear. Yes. But in monochorionic pregnancies, we are going to call them for extra visits between 16 and 24 weeks and do it 2 weekly. Okay, scan, that is what will be the follow-up, and thereafter every 2 weekly. Fine. So I think that frequency of antenatal visit should be absolutely clear in our mind as to why are we calling them frequently and what are we going to do. So we are calling them frequently to look at do ultrasound scans, but ultrasound scans have a different frequency for dichorionic versus vis-a-vis monochorionic. Is it right? Because of the potential of complication. So that part should be absolutely clear. Okay. And 3 things which you are going to monitor the patient for. One is premature labor, that you've already said we are going to include that screening in the first trimester and then again at 20 weeks scan. And blood pressure, each visit to be looked up carefully, and sugar profile. Okay, we need to screen these patients more first, one in the first trimester, then you would like to do it at 24, 28 weeks, and then maybe one more at 30 to 34 weeks you would like to scan. So these are important, and of course anemia. You have to make sure that you screen these patients for anemia. They are more likely to have dimorphic anemia. Is it right? So it is important to screen them for anemia. So these are 4 things which you would screen all the patients for, right? So I think that message should be absolutely clear. We can move on now, Dr. Tendulkar, to you.
Tendulkar.
Tendulkar. Sorry. So pleasure to listen to you always. And this is very important. I just want to know in investigations, what's the hemoglobin you said?
Ma'am, hemoglobin for this patient is 11.4, ma'am, grams per deciliter, ma'am.
And this patient is with you from which gestational age?
Ma'am, from around 12 weeks period of gestation, she is being followed up at our center.
Okay, so when you did a Doppler NTNB scan, whatever you are talking about, have you told us about the color Dopplers? Color Doppler indices at 12 weeks, 18 weeks, any importance?
None of the investigations have been mentioned so far. Shravik, maybe you can just run through the, because we stopped at examination and we have not told them about the investigations. Maybe we can
It is equally important. I think since Aparna is there, she will be talking about Doppler indices starting from 12 weeks, but I suppose you did mention patient on a echo screen with low molecular weight heparin. Can I know more detail about the doses?
Ma'am, Ecosprin was started at 75 milligram, ma'am. Ideally, it should have been on 150 milligram OD, ma'am. And LMWH was given to her at 40 milligrams OD dosage, ma'am. But her weight was around 92, ma'am. So she should have been given at least 60 milligram OD, ma'am. So the dosage were a little less suboptimal, which was started initially only, ma'am, that were carried on. However, in spite of being on LMWH and Ecosprin, she developed hypertension later on in the pregnancy, ma'am, at around 22 weeks, ma'am.
Okay, so suppose your patient, you are continuing, when you would like to stop this Ecosprin and when you would like to stop her low molecular weight heparin?
Ma'am, Ecosprin needs to be stopped at around 36 weeks period of gestation, and LMWH, ma'am, I would stop it at around 12 hours before when I plan for a delivery, ma'am.
So when you wish to plan her delivery?
Ma'am, since she's a
monitor further?
Ma'am, since she is a DADC pregnancy, ma'am, and her comorbidities being hypertension and diabetes, which are controlled, ma'am. So I will plan her delivery. My target would be at around 37 weeks, ma'am. But if the complications worsen, then I might have to deliver her before that. So if I'm planning her delivery at 37, ma'am, I'll stop Ecosprin at 36. And the day before, it depends on her lie, ma'am. If I'm planning her for an elective cesarean, 12 hours before that, I'll stop her on LMWH, ma'am.
Can I ask you how you are going to monitor her with the investigations? How frequently you will be doing? What are the different investigations you would like to do?
Ma'am, right from first trimester onwards, ma'am.
Now she's 34 weeks. So okay. What are the, I suppose the patient is hospitalized.
Yes, ma'am. Or
whatever it is. What are the tests you will keep on doing so that you can prevent complications?
Ma'am, since this patient is diagnosed with gestational hypertension at the onset, ma'am, I need to confirm whether she is developing preeclampsia or not, ma'am. So for that, I would be doing certain investigations for that patient, ma'am. Investigations in the form of CBC, ma'am. In CBC, ma'am, I will do a hemoglobin, which will tell me the level of anemia. Then if she is having anemia, which should be less than, if it is less than 11, she classifies as anemia, ma'am. I need to then type the type of anemia. That will depend on the RBC indices, ma'am, and PBS, which I need to do. The PBS will also give me additional picture of the evidence of hemolysis in case of hypertensive disorders, ma'am. With a hemogram, ma'am, I'll get certain biochemical investigations done.
Do you think you 11.5 hemoglobin for this patient, you are around 34 weeks, still you can think of giving a FCM and get her hemoglobin above 12 or above 13?
What's
the role of giving a FCM now to her?
Ma'am, FCM should be, for this patient, it is not indicated, ma'am. FCM should be given if the patient has anemia. And that anemia, if it is diagnosed to be an iron deficiency anemia, then only we can give her FCM, ma'am. And that also if the level is...
Do you think this being a twin pregnancy, you wish to prepare yourself for a PPH, having her hemoglobin on a higher side, she's in the hospital. What is the harm in giving a FCM to her?
Ma'am, there is no harm in giving her FCM, ma'am. Definitely, it would improve her iron stores. And yes, she is at a higher risk of developing PPH, so I should prepare her. But as such, ma'am, FCM is not indicated. What I can do for her...
Very important is you need to do her serum iron studies and ferritin levels, right?
Okay, ma'am.
You need to do them. Okay.
Ma'am, further to this, ma'am... Ma'am, further to this, ma'am, to see her severity of hypertension, I need to do certain liver function test and renal function test, ma'am. So in liver function test, I need to look for serum bilirubin and SGOT, SGPT, ma'am, whether they are deranged or not. Also, I need to do LDH levels, ma'am, because raised LDH level would show that this patient is having hemolysis.
Liver function test, do you think proteins are equally important?
Yes, ma'am. Proteins are certainly important because in hypoalbuminemia, ma'am, this patient will develop edema and other complications also, even post-surgery.
She has albuminuria and that's why she can have a hypoproteinemia. It is both way.
Ma'am, it is both way, ma'am. If she's losing protein or if she's producing less amount of protein, both ways it is harmful to her, ma'am. So yes, protein levels need to be assessed once a patient is there with us, ma'am. Further to this, ma'am, I need to get certain renal function tests in the form of urea and creatinine to look for her renal clearance, ma'am. Again, in cases of hypertension, this would be deranged, so that would increase the severity. With this, ma'am, at 34 weeks now, I need to get a scan done for her to look for her fetal parameters, ma'am, whether there is adequate fetal growth or not. Along with this, I need to get certain Doppler studies done for the both. So that is what I need to do at 34 weeks. And yes, if I'm planning for a delivery at around 37, ma'am, I will still exhibit. Now she's admitted with me, so I'll exhibit her steroids. So that is what I will be doing with her in ward, ma'am, at around this period of gestation, and keep a close watch for pre-monitory signs for her, ma'am.
So you are saying she has a gestational diabetes as well, right?
Yes, ma'am. It's
controlled
yes.
with the oral drug.
Right? Yes,
she is on this. Now, what is her HbA1c?
Ma'am, HbA1c is 6.2, ma'am, percent, ma'am. So that is normal when less than 6.5, ma'am. And yes, we are monitoring every 2 weekly with a 6-point blood sugar profile, ma'am. So all those values for the last, since 24 weeks onwards, it has been well controlled for the patient. And see, that is also, yes, ma'am.
What is very important is the IVF pregnancies, the babies are large size. Okay. And if she has a gestational diabetes, again, the size of the babies will be little larger. And then continuation beyond 36 weeks may be physically not possible. This one has to understand that IVF pregnancy babies are always large size babies than the normal non-IVF conceived babies. Yep. I think it is already 10:20, and I would like to have more on a Doppler's and Aparna. Maybe it will be a teaching to the student. So I will hand over to you.
Thank you, ma'am. So Shravik and Amit.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So my first question would be, let us start from the beginning once again, from the first trimester. So how would you screen for aneuploidy in twins?
Ma'am, in first trimester, ma'am, anti-NB scan should be done, ma'am, for aneuploidies, ma'am. And that is done, ma'am. And dual marker and NIPT can also be done.
You are giving me a platter. You are giving me a plate. Tell me what you're going to do.
Ma'am, anti-NB scan and dual marker I'll do, ma'am.
Yes. Good. So this is what you have to say, that I will do a combined screening. So combined screening in twins is validated and as good as singleton. Okay. So if a twin pregnancy comes to you in the first trimester, you are lucky, you are, have an IVF conception, and a twin pregnancy comes to you in the first trimester, you will do dual screening plus NTNB. You will combine them and give them a final risk. Now, my next question to you, Shravik, is does it differ if it is a monochorionic twin versus a dichorionic twin? And I mean, is the detection rate the same or different?
Ma'am, in cases of monochorionic, ma'am, it is same as singleton, ma'am. But whereas in cases of dichorionic, ma'am, the serum plasma levels are increased, ma'am. So that is why these serum biomarkers are not to be taken, are not to be considered in cases of a dichorionic twins, ma'am.
So in you need to tell me that you don't want to do combined screening in a dichorionic twin?
In dichorionic, it is NT which is of significance, ma'am. Nuclear translucency is the one which will screen for the aneuploidies, ma'am. Whereas the serum biomarkers will definitely add on, but will not be so helpful in cases of a dichorionic twin. Whereas so in monochorionic, it will be there, ma'am.
Right. So that is your headache or the lab's headache?
Ma'am, my only, ma'am, because I mean, I...
No. So your headache is that you specify that it is whether it is a dichorionic or a monochorionic twin. So please remember that it is your headache to mention that it whether it is a dichorionic twin or a monochorionic twin. After that, the correction is the lab's headache. Okay? Because the level by which the markers change in a dichorionic and a monochorionic twin is different.
Yes.
Okay, so the correction factors are different for a monochorionic and a dichorionic twin. The sensitivity and the detection rate will be the same. So they have to adjust accordingly. So you just have to mention that it is a monochorionic or a dichorionic. There is one another difference. Can you tell me what is the difference? Because what we say is the risk given in a twin pregnancy is something called a pseudo risk. It's not a true risk. And what do I mean by that? Can you tell me? Can you tell me what is a pseudo risk and it's not a true risk?
Ma'am, in twin gestation, ma'am, the serum markers levels are raised, ma'am. So that will give a, in a, false increased risk, ma'am, in case, whereas it would be a normal just without any aneuploidies also.
So the lab is adjusting for that, right? So the levels are raised, but lab is halving the risk, is making the risk half and giving it to you. But so suppose the lab tells you that the risk is increased, but it is not telling you the risk is increased for which baby, isn't it?
Yes.
There are two babies. So how do you determine the risk? So the problem is that if the in the dual marker, the combined risk is increased for a monochorionic risk, for a monochorionic pregnancy, the risk is per pregnancy.
Yes.
And for a dichorionic pregnancy, the risk is per fetus, because in a monochorionic pregnancy, you will take the average of both entities. And for a dichorionic pregnancy, you will take each entity separately and then calculate the risk. So that is a basic difference in aneuploidy screening of twin pregnancy, that in monochorionic pregnancy, the risk is per pregnancy, and in dichorionic pregnancy, the risk is per fetus. Okay. And if the test comes positive, you will have to test both fetuses in a dichorionic pregnancy. And in monochorionic pregnancy, we preferably try to test both fetuses because there is a small chance of discordance, right? And even if you want to test one CVS or one placenta, that is all right in a monochorionic.
Right?
So that is about screening. Regarding NIPT, okay? Now we do NIPT for twins. That is standard, that is universal, it is accepted, and we can do NIPT for twins. So here we come to the next question. This lady is 38 years old. Okay. So that comes us, that brings us to the next question. How would you do aneuploidy screening in a advanced gestation?
Ma'am, in advanced gestational age, ma'am, as such, because dual marker will give increased high risk, ma'am. So
yes.
We can put NIPT, ma'am, in these cases, screening test, ma'am.
Yes.
And if NIPT comes negative, ma'am, then we are assured that both the fetuses are normal, ma'am. But if it is positive, ma'am, then we have to confirm, ma'am, which fetus is affected, ma'am. That we can do by amniocentesis.
Yes. Yes, very good. So basically, if you do a dual screen in an advanced gestation, we can always be sure that, you know, this is comes positive in 1 in 6 pregnancies. So you are actually increasing your false positive rate. So NIPT is actually a good method to screen for advanced gestational age. But here you have one problem. Here you have a donor ovum, okay? So here you have to put the age of the donor and not the mother, right? So here you are doing ODET, ODET. So you have to mention that it's a donor ovum, okay? So here, you don't say that this is advanced maternal age from the screening point of view. She's advanced maternal age from the point of view of maternal complications, but not from the aneuploidy screening point of view. Okay. So this is one very important point from the screening
point. Two important things I think Aparna has to specify, or Aparna has specified, is you should be writing the age of the donor. And second thing is, for the lab people, it is the double marker. It is the twin pregnancy. It's
yes.
Very, very important, dichorionic twin with the donor egg conception. So age of the donor also should go into the detailed history taking. Because
right.
That's very important. If the age of the donor was 28, everything changes.
Yes. Yes. So then there is no role of NIPT. Why do you do NIPT? Just do a dual screen.
Yes.
So you throw NIPT out of the window. So the point is, if you enter your details correctly, unnecessary interventions are not there. Right. Now, the next question that comes is, how do you do preeclampsia screening in twins? Right. So there I come. Then I'm so tempted to ask, how do you do preeclampsia screening in singletons? But I'll not go there. So just tell me, how do you do preeclampsia screening in twins?
Ma'am, in twins, we need to get proangiogenic placental growth factor, ma'am, PLGF, which is one should be assayed once we are when we are doing NTNB scan, ma'am. Along with that, that will, yes, that will give a, if those levels of PLGF are reduced, ma'am, that is again a marker that, yes, this may be progressing to sorry, ma'am.
Next, PLGF.
Ma'am, then along with that, we need to get levels of FMS like tyrosine kinase, ma'am, one. So the ratio between this two, ma'am, that is SFLT1 and this PLGF, ma'am, if it is increased, again, that shows a higher risk of preeclampsia.
My question is first trimester screening, preeclampsia.
These are just later on, ma'am. In first trimester screening, ma'am, what I need to do is PI of the uterine artery. Yes. So a PI of uterine artery, if it is raised, yes, this patient might be developing preeclampsia later on in the pregnancy, ma'am. With this, if I add on the biomarkers of PLGF and FMS like tyrosine kinase, I will get an additive risk of preeclampsia. So that we can do in first trimester.
Okay. So basically, मैं बहुत ऐसे fetal medicine जैसी लग रही हूँ तुम्हें, है ना? लेकिन तुम्हें अपना basics नहीं भूलना है.
Yes, ma'am.
ठीक है. Always preeclampsia screening starts with history examination. So first is historical factors, the biophysical factors, which includes blood pressure. Okay. So we are not doing PLGF. Even at AIMS, we are not doing PLGF. Okay. So a basic preeclampsia screening includes history of preeclampsia, right? You know about gestosis score?
Gestosis score, yes, ma'am.
Yes.
In this patient, it will be elderly and post-IVF, yeah. It will be definitely increased.
So anything which is more than 9 will give you. So this patient is elderly, maybe history of preeclampsia and previous, history of hypertension, any risk factor. First is historical screening. Then you'll take a mean arterial pressure, right? And biophysical includes a mean arterial pressure and uterine artery Doppler, right? The third thing that you will say is biochemical. Third thing, the first is history, the second is biophysical, which includes blood pressure, and the third is biochemical. ठीक है? आप history नहीं भूलेंगे. कोई भी question हम पूछेंगे, आप शुरू history से ही करेंगे.
Yes.
History, examination, फिर biochemical. Biochemical में आपका आएगा PAPA, क्योंकि आप routinely करते हैं PAPA.
Yes.
For doing do PAPA as a part of your biochemical screening for your first trimester. So PAPA and PLGF, if possible. This will increase marginally. So your screening for preeclampsia in twins is basically this only. And if you think it is high risk based on these factors, you might think of adding aspirin. This patient was already added on aspirin because she was IVF and all of those things. And anyway, she has a history and she's elderly and all of those things. So preeclampsia in twins, screening in twins much is very much like preeclampsia screening in singletons, and you can follow this protocol, right? So just one more part about, there are two more aspects that I would like to talk about. One is growth discordance in twins. And the second thing is fetal demise, single fetal demise in twins. So ma'am, can I go ahead?
Yes. Aruna ma'am, you want to say something?
We can go on to the complications that are typical to twin pregnancy. So yes, Shavik, what are the complications that are typical in, I'm limited to twin pregnancy?
Ma'am, there are certain maternal complications, ma'am. So maternal complications in the form of anemia, hypertension, gestational hypertension, gestational diabetes.
No, these can occur in all pregnancies, no? All, I'm talking only about complications, like what Dr. Aparna just said, what are the, which are very, only occur in twins. So what are those?
Ma'am, in maternal complications, ma'am, we can have preterm labor, which can happen to the patient. Then the patient can have...
What about the twins?
Ma'am, per se for the twins, ma'am, in cases...
complications.
Ma'am, twin complications, ma'am, in cases of if it is a monochorionic twins, ma'am. So we'll divide the complications between these chorionicities, ma'am. So in cases of monochorionic twins, we can have higher incidence of TTTS, that is twin-to-twin transfusion syndrome. We can have complications in the form of TRAP, that is twin reverse arterial perfusion sequence, or even we can have twin anemia polycythemia.
Just as an anecdotal thing, have you heard of something called mirror twins? What is mirror twins?
Ma'am, mirror twins is the baby is having hydrops and the mother has anasarcoma. So,
yes, Amit?
It's a mirror syndrome, sorry.
That is mirror syndrome.
That's a mirror syndrome.
Yes.
So what's a mirror twin? Anything to do with a particular day when the division happens on the...
Ma'am, mirror twins are identical twins, ma'am, on day 9. If the
fertilization... They are not identical, they have
Ma'am, similar hair, Manu, this hair curls and hand.
They are in opposite directions. Okay, so if one is left-handed, the other one becomes right-handed. If the hair wall is, you know, concentrated towards the right, the other one it is towards the left. It was just an anecdotal thing. Carry on. What about discordance?
Growth discordance can also come up. Again, that is more seen in cases of monochorionic twins. Again, because of the anastomosis, the abnormal anastomosis which is there, that are the reason for all these complications in monochorionic twins. Coming to monoamniotic twins.
Are you worried about discordance?
Ma'am, increased discordance, there is higher chances of neonatal morbidity, ma'am. If the discordance is diagnosed only when there is a difference of 20% in the weight of both the twins. If that discordance increases to 25%, sorry, ma'am.
How do you decide on whether there is discordance?
Ma'am, one of the method is estimated fetal weight, the difference is 20%, or the abdominal circumference difference is more than 20 mm, ma'am. So these are the two important things which will tell us that yes, this patient, this fetus can have fetal discordance.
How do you decide the percentage of weight difference?
Ma'am, it is the difference between the, we take the difference from the large twin minus the smaller twin, and we divide it from the large twin. So it is the ratio from the larger twin which we take for consideration.
Rukhsar, please mute yourself. Rukhsar, I request everyone to please keep muted. Please don't disturb the Viva. Yes, ma'am, please continue.
There is discordance, Shaurvik. I mean, why are we worried? Like, coming back to my original question, you are going to diagnose discordance if there's more than 20% cut difference, isn't it? Now, how does this affect the twins or their, when will you take a call?
Ma'am, with increasing discordance, ma'am, there is higher chances of fetal initially morbidity and then following which mortality, ma'am. If the growth discordance is more than 40%, there is chances of 60 to 70% of fetal mortality within the pregnancy, ma'am. So that is why we're looking for
the right watch on the
growth, ma'am.
Increasing discordance that is going to be, if it is going to be there.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Dr. Aparna, you want to add something?
Yeah. So I think very nice, Shaurvik and Amit. So regarding discordance, there is a huge difference between when we discuss about monochorionic and dichorionic. Okay. Now the causes of discordance, how do you explain the causes of discordance in a monochorionic and what are the causes of discordance in a dichorionic twin? So just tell me two causes of discordance in a dichorionic twin and three causes of discordance in a monochorionic twin.
Ma'am, in dichorionic twin, ma'am, fetal anomaly is one of the reason, ma'am.
Yes. And
there can be vascular anastomosis, ma'am, that can be.
So you're talking about dichorionic.
Ma'am.
Fetal anomaly and
Dr. Yashashwini, please mute. Yes.
Difference in the placental mass, ma'am. That is one of the reason in basic.
Yes, you could say that. Yes, in a dichorionic twin, but. Yes, I mean, placentation is one of the reasons in a dichorionic twin. And more likely, see, dichorionic is having two different babies inside. So it is their genetic potential also. So in a dichorionic twin. While in a monochorionic twin, tell me three different causes of discordance.
One is anomaly, ma'am. Second is vascular anastomosis. And
so the first is vascular anastomosis. The second is
anomalies.
Yes, I agree. The third is the placental mass that you talked about. Okay, so these are the three important causes of discordance in monochorionic twin. So now we've known that discordance can occur in both monochorionic and dichorionic, and you have defined discordance for us in terms of a difference in weight. Now, how do you manage discordance in a monochorionic and dichorionic twin pregnancy? Now, let us talk about dichorionic twin pregnancy first. Shaurvik, you tell me, at 28 weeks, you have a discordant twin who is having, say, 30% discordant dichorionic twin pregnancy. How would you manage that pregnancy?
Ma'am, at the outset, first, I would be giving a counseling to the parents, ma'am, because these twins with discordance of 30%, ma'am, there is high chances of pre-term delivery in such cases, ma'am. So that counseling is required to the couple. Secondly, ma'am, per se for the pregnancy, this requires an intensive monitoring for such patients, ma'am. So first, at 28 weeks, I will exhibit steroid, ma'am, to hasten the lung maturity. And once I've exhibited steroid, ma'am, then 2 weekly, I need to monitor for growth, ma'am, for such patients. That scan would involve the estimation biometry and along with the Doppler studies to look for any abnormal Doppler studies, ma'am, that is raised or absent endastolic chroma in the umbilical artery. So 2 weekly scan I need to do. Then also along with this, I will keep a short target of around 32 weeks, ma'am. Till then, if she has attained, the fetus is trying to achieve normal growth by then, ma'am, then fine. Then I will continue to 34 weeks. And if 34 weeks also has crossed and she has attained, the fetus is achieving normal growth parameters by then, ma'am. So my termination would be around 34 weeks in such cases where there is a discordance of 30%, ma'am. Again, I would exhibited a steroid at 28 weeks. I'll exhibit a last dose of rescue steroid again at 34 before taking her up for a cesarean or delivery.
So Vic, you were answering beautifully, but I did not understand at 34 weeks still, if it is going well, end diastolic flow you mentioned, if the Doppler indices are growing well, why you want to terminate them at
34 exactly.
Weeks? Right. Ma'am, 34 weeks, ma'am, at 34 weeks, till then, both the babies, there is a discordance of 30%, ma'am.
The discordance is going on same, 30% to 30%, maybe 35%.
Ma'am.
But if the smaller baby still is having a good Doppler indices going and good interval growth, why you want to terminate at 34 weeks this pregnancy?
मैम 34 वीक्स द बेबीज हैव अचीव्ड
देना चाहिए देखो एक टिप मैं दे रही हूं जब एग्जामिनर बार-बार एक सवाल पूछ रहा है तो छोड़ देना चाहिए और बोलना चाहिए कि ठीक है मैम कहीं ना कहीं कुछ हो रहा है ठीक है तो अब बोलना चाहिए कि हां मैम हम उसको कंटिन्यू कर सकते हैं बार-बार नहीं जस्टिफाई करना चाहिए
वी कैन गो अंटिल 36 वीक to 37 weeks also ma'am if the all parameters are
instead of two weekly now you can start doing weekly sonographs also you may do every 5 days also depending upon what's the growth parameters and Doppler indices are going you may do alternate if the diastolic flow is getting off suppose if the diastolic flow is going beautifully color Doppler indices are normal but the baby's growth percentile is going like 5% what you will do
ma'am in such cases with normal Doppler indices even if there is no growth ma'am then termination is the thing ma'am which needs to be done for such cases ma'am so yes by 32 to 34
you may not achieve the growth you may achieve the maturity don't you think so
Ma'am, yes, if the second twin who is not had adequate growth, ma'am, is under stress, that baby is definitely matured, ma'am. So, yes, such things we need to terminate early, ma'am, in such cases. Even if the Doppler indices are normal. So,
iska trick hai ki we have to take an individualized decision in consultation with a senior, consultant. Mm-hmm. And we can individualize on case-to-case basis. Okay. So, we need to see that and we see how we go about it. So, basically, see... A dichorionic growth discordance is much like a singleton FGR. तुम Grataccos based stage based classification में क्या करते हो? Stage based FGR stage 1 when you do not have an absent end-diastolic flow you take till 37 weeks.
Yes, ma'am.
So a dichorionic twin pregnancy with raised Doppler with fetal growth restriction which is not different from a singleton pregnancy. So you can go till 37 weeks, 36 to 37 weeks. Right, even if there is discordance. So if you do not have an absent flow, you can go till 36 weeks. So you can wait and watch, right? You need to give it the maturity unless you feel that so the discordance is because of a fetal growth restriction in one of the babies, right? So you are monitoring that baby like as you would monitor a singleton.
Yes, ma'am.
Right, so you have to maybe increase the frequency of your monitoring, do a twice weekly biophysical profile, do a weekly Doppler and then monitor like a stage-based classification of Grataccos and, take it till term. Try and take it as much as possible. But
higher, then what would you do?
Yes, ma'am.
if the discordance keeps increasing, you know, your Doppler flows are normal, but if the discordance goes up to 40% or 50%, then the risk is higher.
Right.
No?
So basically, yes. So as I said, individualized management, we need to really see what is happening. The baby is absolutely not growing. Again, there is this thing like the baby is falling on quartiles. That is another thing that we see in the late onset FGR. If the baby is falling in its growth quartile, then definitely we need to look in and look at the MCA-PSV, look at the CPR, what is happening, and you know, case to case basis decide what is happening. Dr. Tripti, you need to mute.
Dr. Tripti Fade, please mute yourself. All the students, please mute themselves. This is a common manners of muting, and mute your video because some students are in lying down positions. Please mute yourself. But this is very important, Aparna, what you were talking and what you were teaching, not only here, but there are many more consultants who have also joined. So treat this baby, even if it is a twin pregnancy, don't compare with a very normal baby. Treat this baby also as an individual. And if the Doppler is going, even if 5% growth is going, I will still continue because maturity, prematurity complications, I can avoid. Also, I think it's very important you to tell the thing that neonatal ICU unit in individual hospital is very important. If this is a 40 years lady, IVF conception, and if you don't have a good neonatal facilities, she should be taken to the center where there are good neonatal facilities. All yes. This matter a lot.
Right. So the other thing is that we have just 15 minutes left now, ma'am. So I think we really need to talk about two more things. What happens in growth discordance in a monochorionic twin? Now, one basic concept about a monochorionic twin is we cannot let one twin die. Can you tell me why, Amit?
Ma'am, because if one twin die, ma'am, because of the vascular anastomosis, ma'am, blood flow can be from the normal twin to the dead twin, ma'am. And there is there can be sudden postural hypotension in the surviving twin, ma'am, and IUD of the surviving twin can happen.
So there can be IUD, and not just IUD, there could be neurodevelopmental delay also in the surviving twin. So even if the baby doesn't die, the baby might have 30% chance of a neurodevelopmental chance of, as a postgraduate, sometimes it's good to quote numbers also. So you see, so like in a dichorionic twin, if one of, say, at 24 weeks, in a dichorionic twin, one of the babies is having reversed end diastolic flow, you will not deliver that baby, right? You will say, okay, it's a dichorionic twin, let one baby die, let the other one continue as a singleton. But in a in a monochorionic twin, you cannot let this happen, because if one baby is about to die, like a TTTS pregnancy, one baby is about to die, you cannot let that thing happen. In a TTTS pregnancy, Dr. Shweta Jain, in a TTTS pregnancy, in a trap fetus, in a selective fetal growth restriction, these are the three conditions, or a discordant anomaly, which is lethal, right? In all of these situations, if one baby in a monochorionic twin dies, then the other baby is also at risk. So this is a basic difference between a monochorionic and a dichorionic twin. And in that situation, we have to reduce that baby who's pre-terminal and about to die by some methods. Can you tell us a few methods?
Ma'am, cord ablation can be done, ma'am.
So these methods are called as, so you don't have to know the details at the postgraduate level. So just learn that these are called as vaso-occlusive methods, called as radio frequency ablation or interstitial laser or bipolar cord coagulation. So I think that is all you need to know at this level. But for twin-twin transfusion syndrome, because it is because of vascular anastomosis, and if it is in stage 2 to 4 and you want both babies alive, okay, then you can do something which is called as, what is the treatment?
Laser.
So here, yes. Yeah, so here you are dichorionizing the placenta, making both the anastomoses. You are actually burning those anastomoses and you are making both the twin cells from monochorionic to dichorionic. So that is a basic difference where you are pre-terminal baby, you are reducing, leaving one only baby. While in TTTS, you make both the babies separate and try to, if both the babies are not really, you know, one of the babies is not pre-terminal, there is an option of, you know, keeping the both babies alive, then you do laser photocoagulation. So these are the two things. The last thing about fetal demise, single fetal demise. So in a dichorionic pregnancy, if one of the babies is dead at 24 weeks, so Shovik, what will you do? One baby has died at 24 weeks. You detect one single fetal demise at 24 weeks.
Ma'am, with single fetal demise in a dichorionic pregnancy, per se, the other twin is not at a increased risk, ma'am. Yes, because of the IUD of the second twin, there is release of thromboplastin, which can cause the mother to go into DIC, but at a lower risk, ma'am. Vis-a-vis, if it is a monochorionic pregnancy, ma'am, in a monochorionic pregnancy, if there is IUD of one twin, vascular compromise can happen in the existing twin.
What will you do? Question.
Ma'am, in cases of dichorionic pregnancy, I will advise the patient has to be told that yes, she can go into preterm labor. So she is at an increased risk for preterm labor with a single fetal demise. I will carry on her till at least 28 weeks. And at 28 weeks, I need to exhibit her with steroids. Inform her that yes, if she goes into prematurity, the baby will require NICU support, ma'am. So that is to be told to her. At 4-weekly interval, ma'am, I need to look for the existing twin, the surviving twin. I need to do a biometry and Doppler for the twin, ma'am. So that needs to be done in an existing, in the surviving twin, ma'am, in case of a dichorionic pregnancy.
Why tum steroid bahut dete ho?
Can a parent ask, apart from steroids at 28 weeks, would you like to give anything else also?
Ma'am, if she's developing labor, ma'am, then tocolysis can be given to her, ma'am. But
what delivering her?
Ma'am, for neuroprotection, ma'am, myself can be given, ma'am.
How much dose?
Ma'am, it is 6 gram IV stat, ma'am, followed by 2 gram IV early, ma'am, for 24 hours, ma'am. That is cibaresin.
I think you read yourself again till delivery what we should be giving, everything. Okay. Before Vaishali wants to beat us and say, Aparna, Manju, madam, you would like to say concluding remarks? But Aruna, I must congratulate you. Fantastic job done. Fabulous job done.
We still haven't completed the topic, but I guess it's okay. Just one question, Shovik. What is asynchronous delivery and what would you do in such a case?
Asynchronous delivery is if a twin delivers at around 24 weeks, ma'am, early preterm, as in, so that in that case, we can stop the process of labor and continue the second twin, ma'am. The average difference between both the twins' delivery, as quoted in literature, is around 49 to 50 days, ma'am. So that second twin can be delivered so late. So this is asynchronous delivery, ma'am. In such cases, the lady needs to be under intensive monitoring because she is at a higher risk of having preterm labor. Those babies would be definitely premature. So those babies would require intensive NICU requirement, ma'am.
Preterm labor, what else, I mean, is she at risk of?
If she is at a increased risk of chorioamnionitis, ma'am, because the first twin is delivered, ma'am. So risk of infections is increased in her cases, ma'am.
What else?
Ma'am, the surviving twin can also have demise, ma'am. So that risk is also there in such cases, ma'am.
What about abruption?
Ma'am, yes, ma'am. Abruption also, yes.
So she has to be under constant monitoring. And it's not, again, if you are, like you said, you can only gain about 48 to 50 days. So if it's a much earlier period of gestation, you will have to see when it is happening, because if you're going to gain only 50 days and by that time the second twin is likely to survive, then you can take this kind of a option. Otherwise, yes, there is no point. After 50 days also, if you're going to get a twin who's not likely to survive, the risks will outweigh the benefits.
Yes,
right. Okay. One word about PPROM. What about preterm birth? What is the association of PPROM in twins? Is it increased, is it decreased, or is it the same?
Ma'am, it is definitely increased in cases of PPR.
By how much?
Ma'am, around 30% the increase is there in PPROM.
It's around 20%, okay? But as you go on to higher order pregnancies, above quadruplets, it's about 20%. Above that, it is 100%. Okay. I just wanted to cover that. That's all. We haven't covered the delivery, but I think we have to leave it.
No, very good, ma'am. You are covering those points which are left. So I request all the examiners to do the same. Aparna, you would like to have those highlights which you think are left in this discussion quickly?
Yes, I think as ma'am said, we have to just cover the, I think vanishing twins was left. Yeah. Then role of
survival.
According to me, even the delivery is left.
Yes. Diet and supplements. The role, the dose of supplement is different in twins. Then I think fetal reduction in multi-fetal pregnancy is something that is because they actually get reduced to twins. That is something that is left. Tocolysis, you know, the preterm labor, management of preterm labor in twins is something which is very, very important. Labor management in twins is important because, you know, the progress of labor in twins is different, and delivery of non-cephalic twin, second twin.
So can we quickly just have the take home messages on these topics?
If I just say about the vanishing twin, I feel that I can say that, you know, my first thing and foremost thing is that let us not do aneuploidy screening for vanishing twin. For vanishing twin, please don't send biochemistry. If there is a vanishing twin, just do age and NT. This will be very, very difficult because biochemistry gives a false positive. NIPT doesn't work for vanishing twin because it gives false positive.
Dr. Aparna, if it is
BP, yes, ma'am.
After 9 weeks, then it is definitely, before 9 weeks, it doesn't affect.
I think the 4 weeks difference, if it is there, at 7 weeks, it became a vanishing twin. And then you are doing at 12 weeks, it may still be valid. But 4 weeks minimum distance.
And otherwise, 8 weeks.
Laboratory doesn't accept.
Yes, FAPE remains high for 8 weeks, ma'am. So if the fetal pole had come, then your biochemistry is invalid. So that is the problem with vanishing twins. So please do by NT and age if there is. And NIPT will give you a false positive. So that is a little difficult for vanishing twins. Regarding the supplements, you have to give a double dose of iron. Calcium also has to be in an increased dose of 1500 milligram, right? And the diet, as I mentioned, has to be a low glycemic index diet of 40% carbs. So that is something which was important. From my side, tocolysis is not to be given in twins. That is very, very important. Just give progesterone supplement vaginal if you think the cervical length is less. A patient who's come with preterm labor in twins, we just need to give her dexamethasone. We give dexamethasone 6 milligram. We do not give betamethasone. And if you want to give magnesium sulfate, what we actually do is we give a loading dose. And then we follow it up for 12 hours. We only give for 12 hours. And if the insult is over and we are not delivering it, the baby is not delivered, we do not repeat a dose of magnesium sulfate. So this is the protocol that we follow in AIMS. And if the first twin is cephalic, we can try for a normal delivery. I think that's the most.
Yeah. Aruna, ma'am, I would request you to talk about delivery in this patient or otherwise.
One more discussion
about
inducing or augmenting labor in twins. Yeah. That is another important part, which not only from the exam point of view, when they finally go and start practicing, we should be. So as of even the textbooks say that inducing twins is not recommended. And I don't think they do it in Parkland. But there have been cases where augmentation has been done. And I would go with augmentation. I feel we can augment. Under very careful monitoring, but the textbooks do not support either induction or augmentation. That is one thing. Then what we were talking about, the delivery of the second twin, which is a very, very important thing to talk about. And Shavik, can you tell us what are the different methods you will employ to once the first twin is delivered and you feel that, how long will you wait for the second one to deliver?
Within 30 minutes.
We don't have time.
30 minutes is my target, ma'am, for the delivery of second twin.
Yeah.
So after the delivery of first twin, ma'am, I need to assess the lie of the second twin. I'll use a ultrasound with me, ma'am, which will be there readily available. If it is cephalic, ma'am, then I'll just do an ARM, ma'am, following which the labor has not initiated. Then if the labor has not progressed, I'll start oxytocin and deliver the second twin, ma'am. In case if it is a transverse lie or oblique lie, ma'am, then the thing to do is internal podalic version, ma'am. That is to be done under anesthesia. So with a OT setup and on-call cesarean also needs to be done in case if it requires cesarean. So that setup needs to be ready. And under anesthesia, ma'am, I need to then rupture the membrane.
Tell us how you will do IPV or internal podalic version.
Ma'am, under anesthesia, ma'am, I'll do a controlled ARM, ma'am. Then with ARM, firstly, I'll try to hold the podalic end of the baby, ma'am. My hands would be inside.
Hold the podalic end, or what will you try to hold?
Ma'am, foot.
Huh.
Ma'am. I'll try to hold the foot, ma'am, and then make it a breech presentation and do a breech extraction for the same.
Okay.
So that.
Along with that, what will you do when you're doing the IP, the internal podalic version, and what will your other hand do?
Ma'am, other hand needs to stabilize the fundus of uterus, ma'am. And the fetal head needs to be held, ma'am, so that the lie can be made, ma'am. The breech can be made.
The head needs to be pushed up so that the feet can come down.
Okay.
Okay, only then you will get it into a complete breech position and then you can do an extraction. What is the percentage of second twins who will go for cesarean?
Ma'am, 30 to 40% can go for cesarean, ma'am. In case of first twin delivering green.
Around
15%. 50, ma'am. Okay.
15. Yeah. Okay. Otherwise, you can manage to deliver the second twin. But there is a 15% in the, incidence of cesarean for the second twin. Okay. I think we can call it a day.
Yeah. Vaishali, would you like to say some concluding remarks, Beta?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much, all the examiners. Thank you so much, students. You have done really excellent job facing the examiners over 90 minutes like this in front of 160 people is a tough job, and you did excellent. We are proud of you. And thank you, Dr. Yeah, Menon.
They have passed.
Yes, of course, they have passed with flying colors, and congratulations. Thank you, Dr. Aparna, for bringing in so many good points. Thank you, Menon ma'am, for that old touch to it and delivery and all those points which probably we missed. Thank you, Sunita madam, for giving the IVF touch and adding those important points which common obstetricians probably would miss on. Thank you so much. We have a quick quiz for the delegates who are attending.
I think Puri madam is also there, right?
Puri madam has left, ma'am. She had a meeting, COVID meeting, so she had to leave at 10:30, and I will personally thank her. So we'll have a quick quiz and I'll share my, we'll take 10 more minutes to wind up. So just, I request Dr. Bikram, Colonel Bikram, to please go ahead with the quiz. And delegates, I request you to please put your answers in the chat box. Yes, Colonel Bikram, will you please take over from here?
Yes, ma'am. Yes. You can show the first question.
Yeah.
A patient delivers a twin gestation in which one infant has a blood type A and the...
Sorry.
And the other one has the type O. The patient and her husband, they are both type O. A particular phenomena is proposed as the etiology of discordant blood type. How would you explain this to the mother? I gave you 30 seconds to answer this question. All the delegates can answer it.
The entire chat box is full of C.
Yeah, we have already got not many correct answers.
We can go on to the next question.
Yes, we can go to the next question.
Supervision. The correct answer is the option C. It involves fertilization of two ova within the same menstrual cycle, but not at the same coitus. And it can be even not with the same sperm also. So the correct answer to this question is answer C.
Should I go for the next question?
Yeah, ma'am, please. Regarding maternal adaptations to multifetal pregnancy, which of the following is lower in twin pregnancy compared to that of a singleton? We are asking about lower. Yeah, again, we have lot many correct answers in the chat box. The correct answer to it is the systemic vascular resistance. It is lowered in contrast to all the other three entities which are raised in case of multifetal gestation.
Yes. So we'll go for next question.
Yeah. Among complications that may be seen in twin pregnancies, which of the following may be seen in dichorionic pregnancies? We are talking about dichorionic. Yeah, I can make out that the students are very quick in answering.
Yes.
The correct answer to this question is the option D. It can be a complete mole with the existing coexisting normal twin.
Yes.
Response. Very nice.
Yeah.
The first trimester sonographic image here shows two fetal heads arising from a shared body. How many days after fertilization must the division of this zygote have occurred to lead to the abnormality which is shown in the photograph?
Chat box is full.
Yeah, chat box is full of correct and yeah, the answer is option D. We are talking about conjoined twins. The division after 13 days would lead to such type of abnormality in the twin gestation. So with growing discordance, rates of which of the following neonatal complications are increased?
Sorry, you are not allowed to answer.
Even before I am finishing the question, the correct answer is again the option D. All these things can happen with increasing discordance rates.
They must have been eating, drinking, breathing twins for the past 1 week.
Yes, they must be drinking twins. Yes, eating, drinking twins. And everyone is answering so quickly. So probably it's a good revision for all the students. Should I move ahead, sir?
Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah. Now we have almost had many questions and the questions have already been taken by the examiners. Aparna, there was a question. Will chorionicity be still of concern even in IVF-ET pregnancy?
Yes, so I think I answered that question, but I feel that chorionicity is very, very important. So it is not about the method of conception. It is eventually what is the result of conception.
Yes.
And it has been actually seen that, you know, IVF pregnancy result in more of monochorionic pregnancy. So it is even more important that after IVF conception, you first and foremost determine the chorionicity. And first trimester is the main time when you actually determine the chorionicity.
Yes, thank you. Aruna ma'am, about delivering the twins, do you still believe in delivering them vaginally? And at AFMC, I'm sure you must be doing it. So can you please share your experience?
By the presentation of the first twin, and if that is cephalic and there is no other obstetric indication, definitely we would like to give them a trial. But like I said, we don't induce them. We definitely augment, but in general, though the books do say that you can use mechanical, don't use oxytocin and don't use the other induction agents, but you can use mechanical methods. But in general, we go by the presentation of the first twin, and we have had normal deliveries in FMC very, very regularly.
Okay. Ma'am, are there any precautions to be taken during asynchronous twin delivery, and is it actually feasible?
Asynchronous twin delivery, I feel, is again a controversial area because you are exposing the mother to a lot of
complications, which may be even fatal. So you have to do it on a case-to-case basis. Make sure that, you know, you are finally going to have a favorable outcome, because the maximum you can extend is up to 40, 45 days. Even that, during that time, you need to give the patient complete monitoring and facilities where you can pick up any problem at the very outset. So I will be the first one to say that we haven't done any asynchronous delivery here. So, but if Dr. Aparna's got any experience,
yeah, we have done, and we waited for 11 days.
Oh, 11 days. That's great.
Yeah. It was an IVF conception, and the patient insisted and insisted, but you know, she leaked, and all of those things happened, and 11 days.
Yeah.
We
did it once at around 26 weeks. I was in Mumbai that time, and we didn't have a favorable outcome. After all that, finally, you know, the babies didn't survive. So I, for one, I'm not very sure. Unless it is something like...
Not a very good thing, ma'am. Very, very difficult.
Yeah, yeah, very difficult. And I think it's possible only at AIMS.
That we don't...
Yeah.
You're giving some hope, and at the same time giving so much of risk to the mother.
Yes.
So
very, agree.
Okay. We have few announcements to make. So the next program, the same program next month would be... we are working on, like, today we had almost 450 registrations, but people logged in were around 170. So I have requested everybody, like, if this timing of the day is not suitable, or you want it in the evening time, please put your remarks in the chat box. So that we, yes.
Thinking we could have a Google poll.
Actually, let us not discuss here. We will discuss the managing committee.
Yes.
Evening, everyone. The people are smart to know the WhatsApp.
Yes. So next time it will be Navlev, SKM Medical College would be presenting, and the topic would be abdominal mass in perimenopausal women. So we will discuss all the differential diagnosis. So I would invite you all to please join us again next month. The time and the day would be conveyed to you appropriately. Then we have another announcement that we have Foxy Usha Krishnan quiz, and the Pune round will be conducted on 21st, that is Friday, 5 to 6 p.m. virtually, and the topic is critical care in obstetrics. So please send the students' names and the entries to Ameya or Nilesh, and they would take you forward. Other announcement which I have to make is we have AMOGS, a zonal COGS AMOGS conference on 16th, 17th, and 18th of July. And on 15th of July, we plan to conduct a PG mock viva along with a quiz at AFMC Pune. And I invite you all to join us for this program as well. The plan is to conduct all the viva except the case presentation, which we are conducting in today's session. Except that, there's everything, like the tables, instruments, specimens, spots, everything we would like to discuss in this mock viva. And 15 July would be the date, and the session would be 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. And it would be at AFMC. So we will keep you posted for this also, but please be aware of this and don't miss this program, because again, that will be very helpful. The exams have been postponed because of COVID situation. So even for the exam going students, this session would probably be of great help. So do attend it. And now I have a job of thanking so many people. And I'm so glad that today's session was a Sunday feast that was I could read in the chat box. And all the students will get benefited. First and foremost, I would thank AFMC students for making so many efforts to record, to read the topic, and to stand here in front of all these people and answer so nicely. So thank you so much. I would like to thank Arunanan Menon ma'am and even Colonel Vikram for all the help we have extended. Last 15 days, we were constantly talking to each other. It was the first session, and whatever I could request you, you have provided me with that. So thank you so much. I would like to thank Dr. Sanjay Devi for providing this link so that we can have people logging in larger quantity. Thank you so much, Devi sir. And I also thank Sunita madam for giving this opportunity and arranging this for PG students. So thank you so much. And I thank all the examiners, Dr. Manju Puri madam, Dr. Aparna Sharma, Dr. Aruna Menon madam, and Dr. Sunita Tandurkar for giving excellent remarks. And I know that this day and this discussion will be unforgettable in every PG student's mind, and we will remember it throughout our lives. Thank you so much. And lastly, all the delegates who have joined us early morning on Sunday, thank you so much for spending time with us. Thank you. Take very good care of yourself till we meet next time. Thank you.
Vaishnavi, there is one message which is popping up continuously in the chat box. Is they want the WhatsApp group or something so that they get communication. We will work out how to get those communication number and everything. Let Dr. Bedi help us. And if possible, we can make a masterclass WhatsApp group where the link can be shared.
We have asked them to register. That is the reason we are going to get all their information, their numbers, their email addresses. So we will definitely form the group and convey the messages. And thank you so much.
Thank you. Aparna, love you. Manju, Madam, Kavi, Bejna, love. You never say no to us. Thank you, Bachcha.
Sure, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
I must thank for giving MU India the opportunity for holding this. This is like an innovation, and which I'm sure we will be able to promote it in other specialties also, in surgery, gyne surgery, and then medicine and anatomy, physiology, biochemistry, patho, pharma, micro, almost everywhere this can be applicated.
You have a huge material of education with you. One more important thing, Sanjayji, I want to ask. The people can log up. This video recording, we can put it on our website.
Sure.
Today. No, yeah? Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. I'm ending this session. Thank you.